Hey everyone, welcome back to Constructed Chaos. My name is Alex and I am the Dungeon Master for our Dungeons & Dragons flagship campaign, The Wrath of Zelus. It's been a little while since I've made one of these videos, but I figured it's about time for another recap. This one's going to cover from episode 1 all the way to episode 10, but as I'm speaking to you now, we just finished episode 20, so I think I'll probably do another one of these very soon. That said, I may also put all of them together inside of a playlist, so if you guys want to speed run through it and catch up to where we are currently so you can watch us on Twitch and know exactly what's going on, you can do that. But with all that said, let's jump right into it with episodes 1 through 10 in The Wrath of Zelus. Now bonded by trials and tribulations, destiny and devastation, Taffy the Gnome Sorcerer, Arsinoe the Aesimar Monk, Sarnorin the Elven Wizard, Valifar the Tiefling Barbarian, and Cheryl the Luxodon Cleric, all enjoyed a night of peace on the edge of the burning forest in Jabian's hut. With renewed resolve, they made their way back to the town of Irrigan to take up their unfinished business. Before they left the edge of the forest, however, Taffy was approached by a dryad that granted her a vision. It spoke to her.
Hello, little one. I've seen the light of your heart and the kindness you've done for this place. I sense these woods intend to reward that kindness, knowledge. They have seen much, and yet could tell you so little, so I shall act in their stead. Tread carefully in your endeavors, little one. For not every death by fire is so peaceful as the one you bore witness to.
She saw Jabian's body at the forge, glowing with a dancing light that then slowly faded away. Sinking under the ground, her vision then followed the roots of the trees in the forest until finally connecting with another tree that she recognized as one from Irrigan outside the blacksmith's shop.
Just as these green canopies seek to protect you, so too does this tree wish to protect a little life,
the dryad said to her. She then awoke on the ground, surrounded by the rest of the party that then helped her to her feet and left to continue their journey. Upon entering Irrigan, they were given a rather rude greeting by Otto Blythe, a former acquaintance in the case of identity theft that they'd been trying to resolve before. Cursing them for leaving town without warning and without finishing what they'd started, Otto explained that his friend, Rebels Waggletop, had gone mad after being left in the care of the town's alchemist, Ralph Everly. Rebels, who was at one time a well-respected assistant to the town's Reeve, was suspected by the party as having borne witness to something that may have incriminated the town's blacksmith in the case of attempted identity theft. They explained to Otto that they left Rebels with the alchemist because his mind was already so warped that the poor little gnome could hardly speak his name, much less tell them what he'd seen. So, together, they decided to visit the alchemist, hoping for some clarity as to what had occurred. Curiously enough, Everly then mentioned to the party that he'd resolved his issue with the blacksmith that he'd formerly accused of identity theft. The alchemist then explained to them that Rebels had lashed out against him at one point during his treatment process. Everly felt that whatever Rebels saw had permanently broken him beyond repair. He further explained that the Reeve and the town's guard now shared that sentiment and were actively trying to find the crazed gnome who had escaped the night that he attacked the alchemist. Taffy, then recalling her vision, decided to investigate the tree that the dryad had shown her. And there, cradled in its branches, was a scared and shivering Rebels Waggletop. Taffy was able to comfort him and persuade the broken being to descend the tree with her to safety. But as soon as they made it to the ground, they were spotted by three town's guard that began to pursue them. Reacting quickly, Arsinoe cast a darkness on the area that they were standing in, and the party was able to escape with Rebels and Otto back to Otto's home. There, the party was able to spend a short time questioning Rebels on what had happened between him and the alchemist. The gnome was still unable to speak plainly, but seemed to imply that the blacksmith and the alchemist were actually the same person. Trying to make sense of this new information, they were all interrupted by a knock on the door. Two guardsmen had arrived to investigate Otto's home. The party attempted to hide themselves while Otto welcomed in the guards, but they were eventually discovered and a fight broke out. In the chaos, the party was able to strike down the two guards, who suddenly turned into a red amorphous blob and escaped. Left with more questions than answers, The party split up as Sarnorn, Cheryl, and Balifar chased after the Red Ooze while Arsinoe and Taffy escorted Rebels and Otto away to their safety. Thanks to Sarnorn, they were able to track the Ooze all the way to the Reeves Mansion, where the trail then went cold. Reluctantly, they decided to hide away in a small inn overnight before investigating the Reeve and his mansion in earnest the following night. But while waiting to regroup, the party found and disposed of a series of wanted posters that a group of Suntouched soldiers had left in town on their way through. Once they were rested and recovered from the night before, the party decided to investigate the blacksmith further before making a move on the Reeves mansion. In the dead of night, they moved towards the blacksmith's home. They saw no sure signs of him being an imposter, but closed in anyway. Though they were tricked into attacking an illusion once entering the home, the party was able to dispatch the Red Ooze that did appear to be masquerading as the blacksmith and his wife. After doing away with the Red Menace and inadvertently setting fire to the blacksmith's home, the party rushed back to the inn and bedded down for the night. The following evening, as if emboldened by their recent victory, the group snuck over the wall surrounding the Reeves mansion and made their way inside. Expecting to be attacked by more guards, the party was surprised instead to be up against some oddly armored demons wearing baby-faced masks. After fighting their way through several encounters, they finally entered the Reeves' office. The Reeve was nowhere to be found, however. What the party did find were some tax documents detailing the vast mismanagement of the town by the Reeve. It even appeared that some businesses were being taxed at a rate of 100%. They all debated how this would even be possible for some time until Sarnorn discovered a peculiar book on the Reeve's bookshelf. It contained no writing inside, but had a series of glowing runes on the cover and spine. The party was then able to use the book to reveal a secret staircase beneath the Reeve's desk that led them to some sort of pocket dimension. As they descended, it felt less like they were going down and more like they were shifting somewhere else entirely. At the bottom of those stairs, they finally found the Reeve. He stood atop an altar, surrounded by golden gems, communing with Mammon, ruler of the third level of hell. Around his wrist, the party then recognized, was the arcane focus they'd helped Jabian to craft only days earlier. Recalling Jabian's final request that the bracer not be used for evil, the adventurers knew that they needed to do something. But before they could, the Reeve, Verdithas, attacked the party at the request of his master. The battle raged on until, near the limits of his power, Verdithas requested Mammon to give him strength. His wish was granted, as he morphed into a skeletal being overflowing with dark magical energies. Still, the party was able to defeat him together. Upon doing so, however, the pocket dimension began to fall apart, and Mammon cursed the group as they rushed back up the stairs, watching each step vanish into a void of nothingness behind them. Barely escaping the fate that lay in wait for them below, they made it back into the Reeves mansion and then were able to sneak back into their rooms at the nearby inn. Nervous about their newfound notoriety, the party decided not to leave at dawn. But that morning still carried with it a cruel surprise. In her sleep, Taffy was visited by Mammon and unwillingly coerced into an agreement with him. It seemed that even this great devil was in the dark about the recent events in the world. For this reason, he commanded Taffy to uncover the truth about what stole a section of his domain. In exchange, she was given the same arcane focus that Verdithas had been wearing, and she was unable to remove it. While they waited for a good moment to leave, they were paid an unexpected visit by a fully recovered Ribbles Waggletop and Otto Blythe. It seemed that in dealing with the Reeve and the Red Ooze, Ribbles had regained his memory and the ability to speak. The party decided to part with the golden gems that they had been able to save from their encounter with the Reeve and, instead, give them to Ribbles to give back to the townspeople who had suffered through poverty for far too long. Before taking their leave, they were given one last task by Ribbles, to deliver some of the incriminating evidence that they'd found to the owner of the town, Mirth Solidbrand, in hopes that he could pass the title of Reeve onto someone more fitting than Verdithas had been. And with that, the adventurers set out again under the cover of night towards the capital city of Inneset. After nearly a full day's travel north, the adventurers came upon a guard tower at a fork in the road. But as they drew closer, it became apparent that it wasn't the Suntouched manning the tower. Several of their number lay outside the tower, dead and bleeding. They were greeted instead by a troop of goblins and bugbears. Dealing with them handily, just as the sun was setting, their leader shouted that someone by the name of Lord Crush would hear of this and avenge them. At that moment, Falifar sent the goblin tumbling from the battlements to his death on the ground below. Convinced that they shouldn't stick around, the party began to prep themselves to leave when Falifar noticed a troop of Suntouched in the distance approaching the tower, led by their former dwarven captor, Thardram. The party was able to flee just in time, but not before being seen by the soldiers. Forced to double back a bit, the adventurers fled back into the burning forest and eventually lost their pursuers. At that time, feeling they were far enough into the woods that they couldn't be found, they decided to rest and regain their strength. The knight had other plans, however, as the party was awoken to the screech of an owlbear and its Etin owner. Nearly out of gas, the party was able to fend off their attackers and finally get some much-needed rest. The following day, the party finally caught sight of their goal. After a rough bit of travel, the city of Inneset lay on the horizon, its tallest tower catching the waning light of the sun and reflecting it back, making it glow with amber light as if it was on fire. As the group made their approach, they watched the last bit of daylight fade away. Overnight, they snuck into the city by way of the ward and took up lodging at the Blue Shoe Inn, a shoddy establishment attached to a small rundown pub called the Inky Drink that looked as if it had been years since its last patron. Recalling the directions she'd received from a bandit during their time as Suntouched captives, Arsinoe identified the pub as a secret vetting location for an organization called the Order of the Pin. After following a long string of riddles regarding truth and justice, Taffy and Arsinoe discovered the location of the Order, in a hidden cave at Devil's Rock in the mouth of Inneset's main port. The Order of the Pin had even more surprises in store for the party, when they discovered it was currently being led by none other than Unam Nakim, the Suntouched soldier that had disappeared in the bandit attack all those days ago. After catching up with him, the party was tasked with saving another familiar name from the Inneset Tower, headquarters of the Suntouched. The party was tasked with saving Thiel Willowind. Unam had been told by his former mentor, Esaf Quay, that Thiel was the key to ending this age-old war between Zealous and Eimsford. But, unfortunately, he was told nothing else before Esaf slipped into his deep sleep, a sleep that he had still not awakened from. One thing was sure, however, Thiel would die in 2 days' time without their assistance. And so, reluctantly, the adventurers agreed to their mission, purchased supplies discreetly around Inneset, and gathered once again inside the Inky Drink. The owner, an old dwarf with gray skin and amber eyes, helped them concoct a plan to infiltrate the tower via teleport spell, and sent them on their way under the cover of night. The party did manage to infiltrate the tower successfully, but were discovered before long. After defeating a number of Suntouched soldiers that were alerted to their presence, Cheryl was captured and separated from the rest of the group. The remaining party members were lucky enough to find an ally within the tower shortly thereafter. This ally, a native of Arsinoe's homeland, recognized her as the future leader of her country, a fact unknown to the rest of her companions before now. After hiding away briefly, they were also made aware that Arsinoe's constituents had been working to uncover the mysteries of the ancient World Eater prophecy. Now that certain cataclysmic events had occurred, like the destruction of salvation, it seemed that the doomsday that had been foretold had finally arrived. The prophecy, however, had been twisted and rewritten over time to suit the selfish needs and desires of kings and countries throughout the ages. This agent of Banata now believed that the original prophecy could be found in the ruins of an ancient civilization of dwarven lore keepers far to the north, near the frigid peak of Mount Vernrim. And so, Arsinoe was also tasked with uncovering this truth of truths. But before any further endeavor could even be considered, the adventurers knew they needed to rescue their friend. With the guidance of their newfound ally, they were able to sneak down into the subfloor prison of Inneset Tower, where they eventually found and rescued both Cheryl and Thiel. In doing so, Valifar was forced to knock Thiel unconscious, and, as she fell to the ground, Valifar noticed two small horns breaking the surface of her unkempt hair. Thiel was not an elf. Thiel was a tiefling, and a natural-born enemy of the Suntouched. Shocked by their discovery, but also realizing that time was not on their side, the adventurers began to make their escape with the help of one more of the prisoners they found in the dungeon. Nyx, a satyr warlock from the Feywild, confirmed the suspicions of the party that there was only one way out of the tower, straight through the front door. And so they fled back the way they came until they were met by the court wizard of Inneset Tower, Elwynd. As the party did everything within their power to escape, both Valifar and Taffy were killed by the Suntouched. Cheryl did everything he could to pull their bodies out of the tower with him as they bled out in his arms. But despite his dire efforts, he and Nyx were both captured again. And now, a light early morning rain mists over the city of Inneset, as Arsinoe and Sarnorin escape the enormous tower behind them, pursued by a couple of Suntouched soldiers. Well, that's just about going to do it for our recap of episodes 1 through 10. I hope you've been enjoying this world that we've been building together. It's a ton of fun. If you're interested in watching more, we stream on Twitch every single Wednesday. We also post all of our older videos here on YouTube if you're interested in catching up. And of course, we have all these recaps for you to check out now. So if you're enjoying the content so far, hit that subscribe button, hit the bell, leave us a like, leave us a comment of what your favorite moment in the campaign so far has been. We really hope you're enjoying it as much as we have been. And until next time, go out there and make some chaos.